Good afternoon and welcome to the State School Superintendent Candidates Forum. I'm Gerald Allen, President of the Retired Pickens County Educators Association here in Jasper. We are really delighted to have you candidates with us tonight. I appreciate y'all accepting our invitation. I'm glad to see so many attending tonight, because we all want to know where we're going in the future and what the future holds for us. At this time, I'm going to ask Chuck Allen to come up and give us our invocation and pledge allegiance to the flag. And following him, Jesse Hunter, a GREA district director and the coordinator of this event, will introduce our moderator.
It is our custom in Pickens County to always start our meetings with an invocation. So if you will, I ask you to bow your heads. Our Father, we are so thankful for this opportunity to meet together tonight. We thank you for the candidates that have taken their time to come up. As you know, we've made a lot of progress in our educational system in the last several years. We've worked hard at improving the education for our children. And now we need to go another step and improve even more. And I ask that you be with each one of the candidates tonight, stand beside them as they speak, and open our ears to hear what they have to say. I thank you, Father, for bringing us here safely. I thank you for the beautiful day. And I pray that you will watch over us and return us all safely to our homes tonight. Amen. Oh, would you join me for the Pledge of Allegiance, please? Flags over in this corner.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone, for being here tonight. It's been my pleasure to coordinate this program. And as you might know, there are 9 Republican candidates and 5 Democratic candidates. And we have 5 of them with us tonight. One was coming that had a problem, could not make it. But we're going to have a good time tonight with the ones who are with us. And I know that after you leave tonight, you will know exactly where they stand on the role of the superintendent of schools in Georgia. As Gerald said earlier, this is a very important information we need to assimilate. So I hope that after tonight is over, we'll be able to do that. And we have one of our members of the Pickens County Retired Educators. He is our representative, Rick Jasperse. And for over 30 years, he was the extension agent, county extension agent here in Pickens County. And he's chosen to stay with us after he's retired, and now he represents us very superbly in the State House. There, I give you now Rick Jasperse.
All right. If you can't hear, you way in the back, you make sure you go. That'll make sure everybody speaks up when they're up here. But I just thank you for being here tonight. I really want to thank the Pickens County Retired Educators. I'm fortunate to be a member of it. They took this on early on. It's a great opportunity because it is a change, and a change that really impacts everyone in our state. You know, those folks, these retired teachers, have spent their lives improving the lives of kids in our communities, and they still have a great interest. I get to speak to them every December and take good questions, but they care. And I think you'll see that's why they're here tonight. And I just want to take a moment to thank Jesse and the others. If you're a retired educator, please hold your hand up so we can just give you a thank you. Let's give them a hand. think I'd spend any time telling you how anyone in this room how important education is. Your presence here affirms that tonight. It's 54 days to the primary. Bless their hearts. I know how that feels. So, and we're going to vote on one of you who will be the leader of education in our state. We'll actually do that in November, but the first round is on May 20th. You need to put that on your calendar, because Pickens County has a great track record of high voter turnout. And this May, we certainly need that again. For the audience, I'm just going to give you a few facts about education in our state. These numbers are approximate, you're close, but I think it's really interesting to kind of get an idea about education. When we think about that, we have today over 1.7 million kids in K-12 throughout our 10 million population. You know, I found it pretty interesting that it's evenly split between males and females. I just think that's interesting. There are 2,289 public schools in Georgia and 195 school systems. We have 11,000 teachers. Like my wife, Marcia, here, and my oldest daughter, who's a English teacher, her second year, and it's quite interesting listening to her tales. We spend in state and federal dollars about $10 billion to finance education in the state. And just for your information, the budget we just finished last week, all the new money that came into taxes in Georgia this year, 59% of it went to K-12 education. So what we'll do, we're gonna let each of these folks come, we'll start, oh, I need to introduce them first, I'm sorry. We're gonna let them come up, we're gonna give you their 5 minutes introduction on why I'm the best. We'll set you on the edge of your seat, and then I've got a few questions, but while they're talking, I hope you take a moment and think of your questions. I've got some questions, I've made a number of them, but I think really the key thing here tonight is what you think. What's your questions? What's a burning issue that you've looked at the state, you're here as an interested person tonight? But first on the end, we have Alan Ford. He's from Valdosta. He gets the winner of the longest drive for sure. We have beside Mary Kay Bacallao from Fayette County. Mike Buck, right here. Where are you from, Mike? It doesn't have it down here.
Rome, Georgia.
Rome, Georgia, okay. Nancy Jester, right here from Dunwoody. Here, Willis is not here, but Miss Mays from Decatur. So we'll start down here on the end with Adam, and tell us about yourself, Adam. Good.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. I didn't have to really drive from Valdosta. I'll take that if it gives me any brownie points. But I'm a superintendent in Quitman County in Georgetown, Georgia, on the Alabama line, so it's not as far, but it is quite a ways away. I appreciate the opportunity to be here tonight because I am with my people because I, too, am a retired educator. This is my 39th year. I've been in the business since I was 22 years old, and don't y'all do any of the math. You could get into the new math and it could confuse you all or something. But I've been around a while. I've been an award-winning teacher, a state championship head coach, an assistant principal at a Blue Ribbon National School of Excellence, a principal all over the state of Raven County, Statesboro, and right next door to Gordon Central in Calhoun, Georgia. I was there for 8 years as the principal over there. I was graduating from high school in Cedartown, Georgia. And so I've been around the state. I've been from Blackshear to Sky Valley. I've been from Albany to Calhoun. And I think one of the best things about that is, you know, some people like to stay in a place and move up, and that's fine too. But come on in.
Hang some more. Take that off the time.
But I think that the best thing about that is it has enabled me to learn the many different students and parents and teachers that are in Southeast Georgia, Southwest Georgia, Northeast Georgia, and Northwest Georgia. It has given me the opportunity to see the many, many different faces, the many different cultures that we have in our state. I always say this, that a 16-year-old is a 16-year-old. Nah. When you get 16, they all want a girlfriend or a boyfriend, they all want a car, they all want money, they all want a group of friends. But a 16-year-old in Jasper, Georgia is very different than a 16-year-old in Georgetown, Georgia. Georgetown, Quitman County, then you have a stoplight in the whole county. So life is different, it's laid back. And it's what I truly believe, ladies and gentlemen, is that this state needs, wait a minute, this state needs. It's not a local superintendent, it's not a Metro Atlanta superintendent. It's somebody who's been around the state, who knows the state, who's seen all the issues from pre-K to graduating. And I've seen all of those. It's somebody that can understand the difference between Gordon, Georgia and Gordon County, or Calhoun, Georgia and Calhoun County. And then when somebody calls the state office, they know who you are, who you're talking about. There's a lot of difference between Jasper, Georgia and Jasper County. Because no, this is not where Tricia Yearwood is from. She's from Monticello, which is in Jasper, Georgia, Jasper County. So I want to understand that that's what I offer as far as that experience of being around the state. The next thing I offer is my little platform here. And now, you're going to hear a lot tonight and a lot during the next 54 days about these little phrases and words and stuff. And I could do all that stuff, too. I could find all these cute things and that and the other, because it's time that we talk about education. This is an educational office. It is the chief educator of our state. It is not about politics, ladies and gentlemen. I refuse to hold the pre-K students who go to class right across from where my office is. I refuse to hold them hostage in politics. They're here to be educated. They're here to be loved, cared for. They're here to wipe their noses when it's leaking on a cold winter day. They deserve for me to bend over like I did last Monday to a little crying first grader and say, "What's wrong?" She said, "Mr. Ford, my aunt died and I wanted to tell her I love her one last time." And so we've got to understand that education is about educators, it's about teachers, it's about parents, it's about these children that we should be proud of. You might hear some things about how all the schools are not bad. We don't do this and we don't do that. Well, when any candidate says we, remember this, they're talking about you. And they're talking about Pickens County, Cherokee County, Gordon County. Because when they say we and our state, then they're talking about everybody. You can't say, "Oh, I was talking about this school or that school." No. When they say we, they talk about everybody. So if you've been an educator and you worked hard, and you did your part to see these kids walk across the stage when they were a senior, and you saw all these successes. Not everybody's going to be a success, ladies and gentlemen. They might not graduate from high school, but that don't mean they're a failure. But we're going to work hard to do that. So that doesn't mean that we have failed society. It means that everybody's worked hard. You wanted to be a success. You wanted to do the things that you want to do to become a great teacher. And so when we talk about negative things, we don't need to be negative in education. We need to have a chief educator that is positive about the state, the students we have here, the teachers who have worked very hard, the parents who want their kids to have a quality education. This is where I go from here. If you don't have a little flyer, they're there in the back. These are my priorities. First of all, the Department of Education is across the street from the state capitol. The state school superintendent, which we haven't really done in the past 20 years, is to get up off the 20th floor, take the elevator downstairs, walk across the street to the state capitol, and know these people. These are my friends. They're not to be my enemies. These need to be my friends. We need to have, as you say, open, honest, genuine dialogue.
There's your timer. Okay.
All right.
Sorry.
The next thing is basic skills. Every child should walk across the stage with basic skills. They should not just get a piece of paper. They should understand what my destination in life is. Am I going to be a car repairman? Am I going to college? Am I going to the military? Am I going to technical school? What am I going to be? The second part is you will hear tonight about funding. Yes, our funding is old and antiquated, and it needs to be fixed. And we, but you know how you fix that is you work down here with number four. You work with the General Assembly and the governor and say, "We're already, what do we need to do?" And number one is, as I said earlier, when you close the door and When you go in there and it's a teacher and student, then our educational system is about teaching and learning. We can figure all the other stuff out, all the nice little words and these, that, and the other. But education boils down to teaching and learning. You can take all the computers out of class and have a piece of chalk and a chalkboard. And if you've got a quality teacher and students who want to learn, you're going to have wonderful education.
Time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Yeah, here's our timer right here, so we're good. So keep going, Brad. 5 minutes, yeah.
So Jesse Hunter is doing the timing.
Five minutes, let's go.
Okay. My name is Mary Kay Bacallao, and I'm an educator. I'm certified in math, science, early childhood, and reading. I'm also certified in educational leadership, which is the certification that all superintendents, local superintendents, must hold. I earned a degree in education from Miami Christian College. In 1988, when I started teaching, I've been teaching for 25 years. I also earned a doctorate in education from Florida Atlantic University. I've also been a college professor for about 16 years now, where I teach people who are going to be teachers. And the reason why I'm running for state school superintendent is not because I ever dreamed or desired or hoped to be the state school superintendent. It's because of the educational freedom that I want for all of us. I've given out some bookmarks, if you got one on the way in, and if you can look at it. What I really want is educational freedom for students, because right now, the needs of students are not being met. All students are having to learn at the same instructional level. And those of you who are teachers know that not all students are the same. And when we have standards that makes them all be the same and testing programs that makes them all be the same, their needs are not going to be met. I'm also here for freedom for parents. I'm a parent of four. My husband and I have four children. They all went to Fayette County Schools. Our oldest is at Georgia Tech, and our second is at Mercer, where I'm a professor. The other two are in high school and middle school. For our parents, parents need to have an input into what kids are learning at school. That's why our education in this country and in this state has been so successful. So many innovators, so many wonderful inventions that we've come up with. Why? Because we've had that freedom at the local level where parents can get involved and help their kids. I also want freedom for teachers. As a teacher, you know how hard it is to have to teach something that someone has already learned or that they're not ready for. The teachers need the freedom to meet the needs of their students. And that's what I'm hearing from teachers. These state mandated content standards aren't working. How many taxpayers do we have in the room? Any taxpayers in the room? A few? Okay, too young to pay taxes back there. You know what? Our taxpayers need freedom, because right now we are made to fund educational initiatives that we may not even agree with. We didn't vote to get these Common Core standards, but we have to fund them. So that brings me to the next one, which is the blue one, which is a school board member. I've been serving on the Fayette County School Board, and I noticed that I don't have any authority over testing or standards. All that is decided at the state level. And right now, that's just passed through from the federal government to us, because all of those are things we agreed to when we took the Race to the Top money. So as a school board member, even though I'm a math education professor and found that the math standards were 1 to 2 years behind our former standards, and I spoke out and I did my Excel spreadsheet, big thick report, shared it with Senator Ligon, there was still nothing I could do to change that. So school board members, we want to be more than just the people who raise your taxes. We want to be the people who listen to you and make the changes that you want to see in the schools. Freedom for the last one there is in the purple. I'm taking back the rainbow here. It's got freedom for colleges of education. And because I'm in teacher education, I've seen that our
program has been totally taken over by these new Common Core standards. We have to do them even though they're not research-based and we don't agree with them. And so we need freedom too. Right now, our teacher certification has been contracted out to Pearson, and our students have to pay Pearson $300 to get their portfolio reviewed before they can be certified in the state of Georgia. That's not academic freedom. That's not educational freedom. We need to take that back. So everywhere you look, our freedoms are being taken away. On the back of the bookmark.
Time.
Oh, darn it. I'll talk to you about that later, I guess.
Give me a 1 minute warning so I know when time is coming.
Hey, can y'all hear me back there? I got a high school principal voice. I think I can make myself heard. And listen, I got thick skin. Think about my last name, Buck, and what high school kids could rhyme that with. So I'm good to go. I feel like I am in God's country with God's people. I've been here with a room full of educators, and I love being here. I want to tell you a quick story about educators. I got an elementary principalship. I was wet behind the ears, and I was going to be an elementary principal. And somebody gave me a book called Mentors, Masters, and Mrs. McGregor. And what the book was about, the author asked one question to thousands of people. The question was, did you ever have anybody in your life other than a parent who made a significant, lasting impact on your life? Anybody who said, yes, I did, there was a follow-up question. Who was it? Y'all want to know who most of them were? Teachers, absolutely. And I made up my mind as a rookie elementary principal that I wanted to fill my building with those kind of people. I did, and we were very successful. Listen, we've all heard the buzzwords of rigor and relevance and relationships. We've got to have rigorous standards with high-quality instruction. We've got to have relevance, and we've got that with our Pathways Initiative, hands-on, kids actually understanding why they're learning what they're learning. But I think we have relationships at the end of that, and it ought to be at the first of that. We've got to have relationships with our young people, because the old adage about they don't care how much you know until they know how much you care is the absolute gospel. We have got to have those relationships with people. Got a platform, it's really character, credentials, and commitment. And when I say character, it's not just my character, it's the character we've got to develop in young people. We used to call it parenting, but now educators are being called upon in many instances to be that parent and help develop those social skills that we need, that business and industry are clamoring for. We've got to work on that relationship piece and develop what I call the curriculum of life. We all know we're going to be held accountable for test scores. We've got to be good ACT and SAT and AP, but we've also got to teach the curriculum of life. Do the young people who spend 12 years of their lives with us become the kind of young people we want living in our neighborhoods, taking care of us when we retire? How about dating our sons and daughters? That curriculum of life is vitally important. It's at least as important as the academic side of the house. Now, I got into parenthood late. I've told this story before, and I'm going to share something with you that's near and dear to my heart, because you need to hear the heart. I've got your credentials. I was a teacher, an elementary principal, high school principal, assistant superintendent, and for the last 3 years, I've been number 2 at the Department of Education, and I can tell you some success stories. But you need to hear my heart. You can go to my website and see my credentials and my stand on the issues, and I'm sure we're going to talk about it. But I was called upon every year as assistant superintendent to kind of rah-rah the troops. One year I was going to do that, and I was waiting for the muse to move me. We went to Pigeon Forge the week before school started, and I was having trouble coming up with how can I inspire the teachers? How can I inspire the administrators? Well, this was a very special year for me because my adopted twin girls from China, I was going to hand them over to first grade. This is what I wrote that night when I woke up from a sound sleep thinking about what I wanted for my kids. And I don't think I'm much different from other parents. Bear with me, I have to read this one because I get emotional and sometimes I tear up because I talk about my babies. This is what I wrote when my babies were hitting public education. What I want for my children. I want to know that my children will be safe each day. That loving and caring adults will do everything they can to make sure a safe school is a safe and nurturing environment. I want to know that the teachers I leave my children with will love them and treat them as they would their own. I want to know that high expectations will be set for my children, and that the adults in the building will do everything they can to help my children succeed. I want to know that diversity will not just be tolerated at my children's school, but celebrated. I want to know that when my children stumble and fall along the way, and they will, that there's going to be a loving adult there to lift them up again. I want to know that the teachers will view their relationship with me, my children, and my wife as a partnership with a goal of helping my children maximize their potential. I want to know that my children's experiences at West End will give them roots and a solid foundation to grow from, and wings to help them soar to new and uncharted heights. Who are my children? They are Anna, Christina, and Dylan, and Shaniqua, Carlos, Desiree. They are all the boys and girls who walk through our doors every day. If the lens we look through and everything we say and do in the school business is it good enough for my child, then I know we'll accomplish great things. Teachers rock. The teachers I know fit this bill. That's what we're all about in education. We've got to do a good job of it. I've got a plan for taking us from where we are and moving us forward. I'm so competitive it hurts. I want us to lead the nation in student achievement.
Time.
Thank you. Mike Buck.
Gifted with height, so awesome. Did you say, Representative Jasperse, that you were an extension agent? Did I hear that? I love 4-H. I did 4-H. Do they still do Clovers and Company?
They sure do.
I was in Clovers and Company. How about that? So anyway.
Can you sing for us?
I could, but I won't. Another time. But we did. All over the state, we would travel and sing for 4-H. That was a great experience. So I'm a Georgia girl. I grew up, I did 4-H. I grew up in Muskogee County. That's Columbus, Georgia. My mother is retired from Muskogee County School District. So I grew up with very, very humble beginnings, and lived in the classic three-bedroom, two-bath ranch house. My father's retired, spent 25 years in the Army. He was a Green Beret, several tours in Vietnam, served his country, Purple Heart, that kind of stuff. And so I come from two servants. That's what I know. And they instilled in me a love of education and a desire to accomplish things, do well, and give back. So I have an undergraduate degree in economics from the University of Alaska, Fairbanks. I lived in Fairbanks for 4 years. That's a whole story unto itself. I came back, went to graduate school at Emory, and I worked as an actuarial consultant in both Atlanta and Austin, Texas. So I'm a numbers person. I'm a financial person. And I have three children. So I married a Texan. I brought him back here. I met him in Austin. We have three children, Georgia, Jackson, and Jake, Jester. And they're all in elementary school. They go to public elementary school right down the street in our neighborhood. And it's a wonderful experience. We have great teachers. Sadly, everyone's experience isn't like my children's, though, and I'm very cognizant of that. I served on a school board, and I served in DeKalb, and I was a whistleblower. I found $54 million of deceptive budgeting practices that wore away the accumulated cash reserves of the third largest school district in the state. And it was really illustrative of a lot of the problems we face financially in the state and otherwise. So going through that, seeing things through the lens of a parent, seeing things through the lens of a board member, seeing things through the lens of a financial professional, I decided to research, write, publish about these issues, and I was, I've had the pleasure of speaking all across the state for Americans for Prosperity. I did a video for them about educational finance issues, so we could enlighten folks on how to look at budgeting and fix things in their school districts, ask good questions. And I've decided that we have five structural problems, and I've come up with a plan to attack those five problems, and it's called Focus. And you can go to my website, nancyjester.com, and click on my Focus plan and read about it. Focus stands for financial accountability, opportunities and choice, consequences for failure, upgrading our funding formula, and strong standards for Georgia. That's common sense, not common core. And we'll go through why all of those are very important. The first one cannot be emphasized enough. We are in the dark ages with how we account for money in education in the state of Georgia. We do not have current information available. It is not readily available at each district. And we have done a very poor job of getting the money into the classroom. We've really been bloating bureaucracy. We see this in a study by an economist named Ben Scafidi in the state of Georgia between 1992 and 2009. Student enrollment grew 41%, and administrators, not at the schoolhouse, but central office staff, grew 74%. Had we kept that number just to the same growth rate as student enrollment, every teacher in this state could have an $8,000 pay raise tomorrow. So it's really cost teachers. It's really affected the classroom environment. And thank you. So we'll talk more about all those issues later. I'm so thankful to be here. Thank you.
Y'all ever have one of those days? I just had one. Oh my word, I was late, babysitter was late, and then I got here, was getting my signs out of the car, and I locked my keys in my car. So please forgive me and be patient with me. It has been, we had clubs in the community day at our school, which is another word for herding cats, and I think y'all who are teachers know exactly what I'm talking about. My name is Kira Willis. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so glad to be here, and I appreciate y'all's time. I am a product of public school. My mother was an educator. I have four brothers and sisters. We all went to Roswell High School in Roswell, Georgia. And I am a teacher and educator in public school. I'm a response to intervention specialist. And I also work with our most needy and at-risk students, trying to get them across the stage. And I'm a parent whose children attend public school. I have a daughter who's in first grade, and I have a son who is in pre-pre-K. We're hoping to get him into school with his sister in pre-K next year. I have a master's degree in educational leadership. I have a specialist degree in curriculum and instruction. And my undergraduate degree is actually a BFA in theater performance. And I did that for a bit and decided that the bohemian lifestyle was not for me. And trying to decide whether I was gonna eat or pay the light bill was just way too hard for me. So my grandfather said, you know, why don't you go into teaching? So I said, I don't know. I've seen my mom, I'm not sure. And I did. He said, I'll pay for your first semester. I went and I fell in love. And I said, oh my goodness, look what I can do. I can do two things that I love. I can work with kids and I can do theater. And aren't I the luckiest person on the planet? And so that's what I did for 12 years. And then I met my husband, who was a head coach, and we worked together, and that's kind of how we met. We got married. We both quit our extracurricular activities, because y'all who are teachers know that kind of eats up your life. And 9 months later, we had a bouncing baby girl, and we never looked back. He is an assistant principal in a middle school, and as I said, I am a graduation coach, RTI, 18 years in the classroom, English, journalism, as well as theater and performance. So when I talk about education, I'm talking to you about it as someone who is actually still in the schoolhouse, someone who is still there seeing exactly what's going on with our kids, seeing exactly what's going on with our teachers, and seeing what's exactly going on in our communities. And I know firsthand exactly what's going on via the legislation, via the bureaucracy, via good teaching, excellent teaching, and maybe not so good teaching sometimes. But I think we need to understand also what the purpose of public education is, and not many people really talk about that. And the purpose of public education, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm sure you will all agree with me, is to graduate self-sufficient, independent people who can contribute to society in a positive manner and help our 21st century America compete in the marketplace that is global. And that's our job. And we can do that in a lot of different ways, and I really have a three-tier plan on how to do that. But we also have to understand that the state school superintendent is not the CEO of education. That's the governor's job. The state school superintendent is not the CFO of education. That's the legislature's job. What the state school superintendent does in his or her job is to make sure that we're sort of the director of HR. We make sure that everyone is on the same page, everyone's playing the same tune, and everyone is also understanding that we have to follow the rules and the laws that the legislature gave us, and we have to follow them with fidelity, whether we really like them or not. But as an educator, as someone who is in the schools, I can tell you that I can speak to the legislators, I can speak to the State Board of Education, I can speak to the governor, and I can say, we need to step back and make sure that we understand the implications of these rules, that we understand the implications of this legislation before we go ahead and throw it down on our kids. And how many of you are retired teachers? Excellent. How many of you are teachers now? Go us, right? And there's a lot coming down on us. It's a lot. And every time we turn around, there's a change. Every time we think we got everything taken care of, something else happens. And it's too much. It's too much for our teachers. And you know who else it's too much for? It's too much for our kids. Because if the teachers aren't happy, guess who's not learning? Who's not learning? Our students aren't learning, and we need to make sure that they are learning. So, we look at the governor's vision, the legislative dollars, the State Board of Education, down to the local school boards and the local school districts. And there's three different things that we can do that the state school superintendent actually has say in. One of them is funding. We need to work with the legislature to revitalize and revamp our state funding education. It was passed, the QBE formula was passed when I was a junior in high school. That was really 5 minutes. It was not that long ago.
Hello. And actually, now I understand what it's meant by when it says the last should be first. Because there's really nothing more that I could possibly say to you all that you all have not already heard so wonderfully described by each and every one of you that's here. And I'm glad that I'm where I am now. Than where you are, because now you have a big decision to make. Because I realized one thing tonight, in my salutation I said, you know, that I am one of the many great people that are running for the candidate of Georgia State Schools of Superintendent, the position of that, and I see why I said that. Because I did spend some time on the website to just to know the people that I am running with. Because even after this race, I plan to work to make sure that I'm a big part of, you know, and actually a big part of the state of Georgia in any way that I can be. And quite naturally, I expect to win. So, but to say that, just to give you a little introductory to me, because they are all fine and wonderful candidates, and you heard the numbers crunch for you. There's nothing much more to say other than, like the one gentleman said, to hear the passion and the heart of the people that's up here. And I'm convinced that every one of us have a passion for children. And I think that even with the retired teacher, even with the teacher that's out teaching today, we all are here for the children. And I think about, and I'm sorry I get so compassionate about what we're doing. I'm so compassionate about to hear the other people that they're compassionate, because I was really concerned about that. But to think about our children, our future, is the most important thing to do. And to know that we have people that honest people that have God fearing in them, people that love children, people that want to see not just themselves be promoted, but to see their children be promoted. And not to look at them when they're in college and when they're adults, but look at them now and see where they can be and see a bright future for them. And that takes resources being spent and used and utilized the correct way. That takes parenting, being connected with school from every arena, not just say middle class or, and I'm very fortunate I've had the possibility of being raised in a, what would, at the term that was used in college as a, what was it? It was said something like poverty level. And I was so shocked. I was taking an economic class and I was just mesmerized because I couldn't understand, because the salary of both my parents combined together was lower than what was on the board. And it just messed my world up to where I had to get on the phone and call my mom and say, Mom, why didn't you tell me that we were poor? And she said, sweetheart, what do you thought we were? And I said, I thought we were rich. And I was rich because I had a family that loved me and that education was put first. And I was actually one of the ones that was not expected to be able to go to college and to graduate through high school. I was pegged as one of those that was going to be one of the neighborhood kids that would be pregnant and somewhere doing other things other than going to school. But that wasn't what was instilled in me in my home. And I just thank God that my parents and that my mother, who was there behind me all the way, all the way, and she's 80 now, and she's still behind me. But I realized then that it wasn't just me. It was all those great teachers that was behind me that was pushing me and egging me on to go ahead and do something great for this world. And now I see why. Because there's so many children that don't have parents pushing them and saying, you can do this. You can make a difference. You can change your life. You can change your world. And with that, I just want to say that I realized I didn't introduce myself, and I will introduce myself. I'm just going to do it in reverse, and that's okay to me. You know, there's always, you have a platform written out, everything written out, but then your heart gets up here and you realize that it's about speaking from the heart. It's about doing what's right. It's about saying that it doesn't matter whether we are black or white or whether we are Democrat or Republican. It's not about what the space that separates us. It's not about the homes that separate us or the clothing that separates us. But it's about the coming together for the sake of children. And I've seen America do it so many times. They could be at each other's throat for everything else. But when it comes to a child, America's there for children. And I just expect that when you go home tonight, that you would look in your heart and that you would make a sound decision to say, I want to do something that's different. I don't want the same in education that's been done when I was a child and when my children came up, and keep seeing us repeat the same mistakes over and over again in education, but to see something different. And before I do say that, I just want to say I did bring my children tonight. They're beautiful and wonderful children. They support me, Jasper Mays, Whitney Mays, and Aaron Mays. Thank you so much. My name is Jurita Forehand Mays.
Lastly, we have Roger Hines. He would like to tell just a moment about Richard Woods. He cannot be here tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator, for letting me do this, and I will not need my 5 minutes, I don't think. I'm from Kennesaw, the land where, Mr. Representative, if you don't own a gun in your house, you're illegal. We don't enforce that law, but don't tell anybody because it has worked for 3 decades. My great friend Richard Woods is running for state school superintendent. I'm an old English teacher. In fact, I'm one of you. I retired in 03, and in fact, have worked and taught English for Chattahoochee Tech ever since. But I'm a sucker for words and for slogans. If you saw the little card on your seat, it says, ready to lead. But it tells you why Richard believes in his heart and mind that he is ready to lead. It says, classroom experience, administrative experience, and business experience. Richard has had private business experience, and he knows that although schooling is essentially about kids, folks, it is also about equipment and food and buses and toilet paper and such. So he wants to go to the legislature and be thrifty. He's been my friend a long time. In fact, I ran against him for the same position 4 years ago. He made it to the primary and I didn't. He is absolutely committed to his task. On a larger, longer push card, if you saw it on your seat, it says this: education should be personalized and not standardized. If Richard were here, he would tell you that he believes that this excessive testing has killed much of the joy. Does taking your temperature 15 times a day change your fever? He's very concerned with excessive testing. He does not want the federal government to run education. The 10th Amendment doesn't really allow it to. So thank you for looking him over. Richard Woods, by the way, he understands that he, the elected one, must work with the state board, the appointed ones, and that he must also be an emissary to the legislature. So thanks for looking him over, and if you look over that push card and that card that's on your desk, I know that he will appreciate it. Thank you, and thank you, Mr. Moderator, for letting me slip in here.
Yes, sir. Okay, now the fun part, is, which I think is the most nightmarish part. I've been there, But what we'll do, I've got two or three questions. You know, I've really got eight or nine, because I sure want to have 45 minutes at least of discussion and kind of open it up to thinking. For the candidates, kind of answer quick, because I think if we, you know, 2 minutes at the most, Mr. Timekeeper,
2 minutes.
But less is better. I mean, think about the question. You're going to have time, and I'll start down here with you with the first question. The next question, I'll start with you, just so everybody gets that fun first question. But so let's get started. And we're going to ask you, I'm going to ask two questions, and we're going to turn it over to the floor. Okay, so be thinking. Okay, I started out by saying we spend billions on education. And there are valid concerns about the results of spending that we do in our state. I think most people would like to know what recommendations that you would make and how you would focus the dollars that we spend in the state to improve education. Have we got a handheld mic?
Ready?
Here, just to make sure.
Oh, yeah.
Give it a second.
Best thing that we need to do is to start from bottom up. Sometimes we start by hiring new assistant superintendents and new lead teachers and new academic coaches. But what we need to do is to make smaller classroom sizes. My wife teaches, 2 years ago she taught a class of 21 kids. This year she's teaching a class of 27 kids, only 5 kids. But it's all the difference in the world. You can just ask her, you can see it on her face. I see it every Friday night when I get home. She's had a long week with 27 kids. She teaches 4 different classes. That's over 100 and something papers she has to grade. And she's determined to do it right. And so I think if we had the money, that we need to start from the bottom, smaller class sizes, and then work our way up. Because if everything is going well in the classroom, you don't need to worry about another assistant superintendent running things.
The first thing we need to do is we need to send the $200 million back to the U.S. Department of Education, because that $200 million has cost us so much more than that, because it's cost us to have to get all new curriculum materials, hire new people to supervise teachers in a very detailed, prescriptive way. And also it required us to change our testing system. Now, when I taught elementary school, we had an individual reading inventory, which was a test of reading level. It was free, pretty much very inexpensive. We just all gave the test. Now we're looking at spending $8 million to align our testing with our new standards. And first of all, you know what I think about the new standards. So you know, you think, oh, that's a waste of money. So much of what we're doing is a waste of money because it's mandated by people who aren't paying for it. When I was on the Fayette County School Board, we had 177 days of school and only 5 teacher planning days. That was before I got elected. After I got elected, my goal was to return that money to the classroom where it could be effective. And so what we did along with the rest of the board was we were able to have 180 student days and 10 teacher planning days, because teachers are going to plan whether you pay them or not. We were able to actually cut the budget and still have more days. So that money, I didn't vote for the budget. Here was my rationale. I would only vote for the budget if we increased percentage-wise the funding that was going to instruction. And even with all those changes that we did, we still didn't do that. So I'm going to be sure that if I am elected as state school superintendent, that we're not going to add additional requirements that are going to take money away from instruction.
All right.
really don't think I need this. Listen, we make things too complicated in education. The single most important variable in how a child is going to perform in school, once they enter the classroom, once they're in that classroom, is the skill set of the teacher. He or she is going to be pivotal in how the students move in a given school year. I found in my career, you create or eliminate 95% of your headaches with who you hire. We have got to restore pride in the profession. We have got to continue to attract and keep the best talent available. We've got to fairly compensate our educators. We've got to get them what they need to be successful. If you hire well, if you give the teachers a sense of vision, and you get them the resources they need, they will be successful. That's where we have to focus. We've got to restore funding to the point where our schools can operate for 180 instructional days. It does not matter how strong your standards are, how good the teachers are, if they're not in school. We have to get the boys and girls into school for the 180 days, which, by the way, are prescribed by law. Right now, state of Georgia, 2/3 of our districts are not conducting class for 180 days. They just don't have the funding. So get the best and brightest you can into the field. Compensate them fairly. Give them the resources they need, and good things will happen in education in this state, and you will see the needle move on student achievement. Thank you.
Thank you. How we spend our money will drive our results, and we're not doing a very good job of that right now. So every state that borders Georgia has a higher graduation rate than Georgia, ditto Mississippi, Louisiana, and Texas. And every state that borders Georgia spends less per pupil to get that. We have plenty of money. It's not going to the right place. It's not being driven into the classroom because we have bloated bureaucracies, and we don't have any way to direct that money, whereas a state like Texas has a system called the Financial Integrity Reporting System of Texas, FIRST. And it has 20 indicators that push the money into the classroom. It will not allow them to put the extra teacher, extra kids in the classroom because they're not gonna let you do that. They will limit the amount of spending on bureaucracy and overhead. They are just transparent. They do online check registers. That's a priority of mine. So you can see how your tax dollars are being spent, and it's incentivized to go into the classroom, to go to teachers. The extra $500 million that we're seeing appropriated now, if we had just adjusted the salary scale, if we had leadership that said, hey, let's adjust the salary scale and give these teachers a bump, every teacher could have gotten a $4,500 bump right now. And then that would have gone to teachers, not sucked up into bureaucracy like it probably will happen. So there's real reasons why we're seeing this. Tennessee has lapped us. They have a graduation rate of 86% now. They have achievement districts. They don't let schools perpetually fail anymore. Texas has a whole list of consequences. We just subsidize failure. We just continue to send your state check no matter your achievement levels without any ramifications. We have plenty of folks achieving great districts, but those struggling districts are costing all of us, are costing all of our tax dollars that from the state go back to those districts. Thank you, Nancy. I agree. We've got plenty of money going into the schools. What's not happening is it's not necessarily going into our classrooms, plenty of money going into education, but not enough money going into the schools, and not enough money going into our children's education. I saw a book a couple years ago, a novel that I looked inside that I was assigning to my students, and it, one of my classmates from the class of 1986 had her name in there. Same book. That's ridiculous. That is not okay to have a book that is falling apart that is being assigned to our children. So I do think that we have plenty of money that is half of our state's budget going into education. What's not happening is it's not going to our children and it's not going to our teachers.
But what I think we can do, or what I would like to see happen, is the sort of my silver bullet to education is to afford our children the ability to follow not only their passions, but also their promise. And that means school choice. I think we have beautiful, we have a beautiful building here, and we have some students who might be able to follow some passion and do some joint enrollment, or have the technical college offer specific courses that may not be available to the students in their own school simply because of size, or because there's not enough demand at that one specific school. So you can combine counties, and you can do that very easily by taking your funding and assigning a per pupil amount of funding for our children so that they can choose their school, they can follow their passion, and they can follow their promise. And if we can do that, then what we can do is make sure that the money is actually going to the child and going to the teachers. Thank you.
I too agree that we have more than enough resources. $10 million is a lot of money for us to do what we need to do in terms of education. There's third world countries and other countries that are doing much more with the money, but much less than what we have here in the state of Georgia. The key emphasis would be put on technology. It's unfortunate that we're always 10 years behind when you're talking about here in with corporate America with technology. The school is always 10 years behind. So we just need to get caught up with the times. So we're going to prepare our children for the future and for the global world that you know today that we're actually competing against in jobs and everything, that we need to prepare our children with technology. Not only just technology, but we also need to get help in the classroom. We have teachers on the line every day, on the front line, giving their lives towards that, but yet they're not getting paid. Most teachers are out somewhere working part-time, doing something to bring extra income in. We need to stop that so they can do their love and their passion in the classroom. So we need to use our resources for that. And then protect our children in our schools. That's another place that needs to be. We don't need another Columbine, not here in America, not with the technology we have today and the money we have today. Thank you very much.
Great. Next. I'm trying to toss up. I've got this one question that I sure do want to answer, but just ask, but I was kind of going to go to this one. And the state school superintendent, as y'all know, is elected. That's why these folks are here. And the state board of education is appointed by the governor. And then you also have me, the general assembly. And sometimes this has been a very rocky relationship. And I guess the question I have, this is something I wanted to know, was what are your plans, you know, to create a relationship that benefits the kids, the teachers, and the taxpayers in our state?
Even before I thought of running for state school superintendent, is it not on? Even before I thought of running for state school superintendent, in fact, this is what actually gave me the idea, is I went to 6 out of the 8 listening sessions for the legislature. I don't know, do you remember seeing me there?
I did, yes.
And what I did is I tried to convey information about what was going on at the school board level and as a college of education professor and teachers, and how the policies were impacting us, to try and communicate that with them. And then I also spent some time at the Capitol, saw me there too, some time at the Capitol trying to convince the legislators not to pass House Bill 897, because House Bill 897 was going to take away separate reading tests and separate writing tests. And so I'm glad they didn't pass it, good job. And I was so excited about that. So talking with the legislators and the state school board members, I've met some of them, and I see my role with them to be someone who has so much information and knows all the facts and can get all the research to present it to them, because some of them aren't educators and some of them are businessmen and they may not understand the full implications of the decisions that they're making. So I see it as working with them to try and get them to come to consensus and get them on board. The other question was working with the governor, was it? No?
Yeah, altogether.
Altogether. I did have a chance to meet with the governor
a couple weeks ago, and his education advisors were there, and I was telling him about some of the bills and why we shouldn't have eliminated our reading and writing tests. And actually, that was taken out. That language was taken out of eliminating the reading, the writing test. So it was able to have an effect there. I whoever the governor is who's elected, whether it's David Pennington or John Barge or Nathan Deal again, my role would be to make sure that those people are fully informed about the decisions they're making, because the governor appoints all the state school board members and the Professional Standards Commission, the people who certify teachers. So that's hugely important.
You know, I've spent my entire career building bridges, and they're really pretty simple. They're based upon relationships. We will never be as good as we could be in public education if we don't get the home, the schools, and the community members on the same sheet of music. At the state level, we have got to have good relationships between the superintendent, the board members, the legislature, and the governor's office. We will never be as good as we could be unless we forge those positive relationships. Fortunately, in my case, I'm already doing it. I served 3 years at the State Department of Education. I have relationships with our state board members. I have spent time across the state in the governor's office and in the legislative hearings. I've already forged the relationship with business and industry as we built out our career pathways. One of the things that I insisted upon as we worked on these career pathways is 50% plus one of our advisory committees are going to be representatives from business and industry, because ultimately they're taking our students, whether right out of high school or technical school or four-year colleges. So we've worked on establishing those relationships. I was in a city school system. In the city school system, first you've got to convince your local board to approve your budget. Then you have to go across the street to the city commission and get the city commission to approve your budget. So I know what it's like to have to forge those relationships, and I'm doing it right now. I see the value in those relationships. I know that we have to have everybody on the same sheet of music. The skill sets that I've developed with 31 years in public education will help us continue to do that. Thank you.
I'll let you in on a little secret. I don't think I've ever shared this. I was actually asked by a legislator who's a member of leadership in the state legislature to run for this office, because he thought it was very important that we have much better financial management, somebody who's committed to school choice and the types of reforms that we've seen that are improving other states. So I thought about it, prayed about it. So I have those relationships with folks in the legislature right now. And in fact, I've had a forum for years called Coffee Talk with Nancy, and I would invite the political leaders to come down to that, and they would come, and we would have parents and everybody, parents and citizens and taxpayers come, and we'd put on a forum and discuss nothing but education. And it was a benefit to them and their districts, and we'd go all over the metro area, and it allowed me to build relationships and understanding with them as well. So I have those relationships now, and I look forward to continuing to have them and continuing to lead. Thank you.
I like this question, because we need to remember again who the CEO of education is. Not the state school superintendent, it's the governor. The CFO of education is not the state school superintendent, it's the legislature. And yes, the State Board of Education is appointed by the governor, so we need to make sure that we remember that we are aligning with the governor's vision, and we all need to play nicely together. And what I see, unfortunately, is not people not playing nicely. What I see is a bunch of people pointing fingers at each other and fighting over educational policy instead of working together for our children. And that's what we need to make sure that we understand. This is not about a personal agenda. This is not about someone saying, oh, I'm gonna use the state school superintendent and I'm gonna jump ahead and be governor or a senator. That's not what this is about. This is about our children. This is about making sure that the educational policy is for our kids and that we are all working together with that in mind and working together for our children through the governor's vision, the legislative dollars, the State Board of Education, and then taking it down to the local schools and the local school boards by someone who understands teacher speak, by someone who understands all of those acronyms that you really need a cheat sheet and a page for. Y'all know what I'm talking about. But I can speak that, and there aren't that many people who can, because I'm in the schools now, and I understand exactly what's going on. Man, I was waiting for this question.
What I would say to this is that I think I've been at least the last 20 years waiting on this question to be asked of me. Being in the halls, complaining with all the other teachers about what we would do and how we would do it. I think the solution to this is to get state representatives as well as anyone else that would have any authority of any time or any legislation that's being done over schools or making decisions, that they come into the school, that it be required for them to come in on the front line just one day. We don't even need a week because they wouldn't last a week. But we just wouldn't want to be there for one day, just one day. Walk in my shoes and then tell me what needs to be done. Because their whole mindset would change. Just one day on the front lines, putting their life before children when you have a plethora of different behaviors and learning abilities and all of that, all in one room. So I say, just spend one day. And I think that that should be something that should be done statewide, and it should be all those that are making decisions concerning education. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to build bridges because the state school superintendent for 12 months, 365 days, 7 days a week, should be talking to him. I should come and eat supper with him to find out what's happening in the world. And it's not just about from January till March. It's about January to December, because they'll tell you, it's an ongoing job. It's not just a 40-day job anymore. It's a 365-day job. They're planning, they're making bills, they're talking to the public. And so the job as a state school superintendent should be to communicate with the governor, the lieutenant governor, the general assembly, the board of education, the board of regents, the technical college board of regents, communities, everybody for 12 months, because we build bridges with everybody. The state school superintendent, I should be here informing you of what's going on, what's happening in education, not just the campaign. The next thing is that I would take to build the bridges maybe a little better, or to have a little close relationship, is I would appoint a state school superintendent. We're spending lots of money to run to get a job that don't really pay that much money. You don't get a house, you don't get a driver. Time's up. Okay.
He's over here. Great. So what we've got, I'm turning it over to you now. So Mr. Connolly, raise your hand, stand up. Microphone man. Give it a second.
One.
And there you go.
It's working.
Yeah, no problem. If you have a question, now's your chance. Now we got six people here that I've just witnessed have a lot of passion for education. And you raise your hand, we'll give each of you, let's answer quickly so we can get to our folks.
Start with Buck.
From a candidate standpoint, what would, or Mr. Buck, what would you do on the state level and then the local level to increase our AP student activity? I was fortunate, we had a choice. I lived in Cobb County. We have a home and property in Gilmer County, but I chose Pickens because of the AP curriculum that was available here and the student class size that was not available in Cobb County. What would you do to increase that AP student activity? Because that makes the difference in college entry.
Oh, I'm so glad you asked me that. And first of all, I'm gonna give you some good news on advanced placement exams, and you're absolutely right. It is vital to have that top-end curriculum available to all of our boys and girls. The state of Georgia is number nine in the country on the percentage of our students taking and passing advanced placement courses. That's an incredible number, and we have a much larger percentage of our students taking. We increased accessibility through our virtual school so that we've got AP program available. We are increasing the megs, the pipes that will get internet access to all our schools from 3 megs per school to 100 so that we can pump out more of this content to them. But getting them the content alone is not enough. We've got to train up our teachers. We have AP seminars in the summer that we've been able to provide so that we can draw in the teachers who are going to be teaching that AP, that college level content, to our kids and share best practices with them. We can archive that those best practices online through GPB so that any teacher out there that might be teaching advanced placement courses can access those best practices online on their own time. Because frankly, in most districts, they're not going to have professional learning days for the teachers, and we have to make it convenient for them. So you've got to make it a point of emphasis. When I was a high school principal, one of the first things I did was to keep building more of those courses, and I didn't set prerequisites. I encouraged all of my boys and girls to get into those classes because it's one of the best predictors of how young people will do when they get off to college, is that exposure to that high-end curriculum, those high-end standards. So I think you're absolutely right, and I will continue to do those things to make sure they've got access.
Okay.
Perfect.
I'm concerned a little bit about the passage rate for AP in some of our schools. We've expanded access in many areas, but not the efficacy of the teaching. So we see that in many schools, you can have the AP courses, but you'll have a, you know, 10% pass rate. And so that's not acceptable to me. So I think we do have to address that. Part of the issue too is then teacher quality and teacher training for that. And then that goes back to funding and how we do or do not push money into the classroom. If we are not able to hire the best and the brightest for that endeavor for AP, and we know we have issues hiring AP physics and math and so on. In fact, we in the metro area, there's a lot of foreign teachers that get hired for that. And so that's a problem. If we are able to increase salaries, then that will help mitigate that problem. So again, it's pushing money into the classroom and making sure we're rewarding the success we want to see there, the right incentives there. And I think the state could have a role to play in that. Obviously, that's a local control issue too, but the state can incentivize that with the way they allocate the resources. And that's a lot of what the state school superintendent needs to offer leadership on. How are we gonna best incentivize the money coming from the state to the local district to have those outcomes we want, and AP is one of them if collectively that's what we want to do. But we need to make sure too we're not burdening our teachers with overly large AP classes. I've had an AP history teacher talk to me about that. It's almost impossible for them to grade all of the essays they get because so many kids are being encouraged to take that class, and it does bring down their ability to really help those kids write the essays well. So money allocation, I think, needs to improve there.
I work at a high school where we have lots and lots and lots of AP offerings, AP environmental science, AP microbiology, AP macroeconomics, lots and, but the one thing that we encourage our students to do is actually put their rear ends in the desk in the classes. And what I've seen in other schools, and I don't, I'm pretty sure that this is not the case for you, sir, is that schools sort of relegating and being a gatekeeper of which children will take the classes and which children won't simply based on their previous grades. I think it's admirable for any child to say, I want to stretch myself and I want to challenge myself, and therefore I'm going to take an AP statistics class when, you know, I wasn't all that great in calculus. But we're going to do that. And to be able to offer the choices and to be able to not put a gate on our children and saying you can take this class if you want to. What Florida does is they don't require their children to actually take the test if they don't want to. We are going to expose you to this curriculum. We are going to expose you to this high rigor. We are going to expose you to these classes. But if you don't feel comfortable taking the test, you don't have to. You're not going to get college credit for it, but what you are going to get is the real, live, hardcore, meaty curriculum
that may not be offered in the non-AP courses. So I think just affording our children the ability to take those courses without putting a statute of limitations on those courses or on those children would be the best bet to get our kids to really open up and take those courses.
Thank you for asking that question. I'm concerned with AP because I think it's a very important one. Not to say that every child needs to have AP courses to get into college, because it's not true. Not every child is going to be cut out for college. That's why we need to also have technical schools and other things that children can do, because some children, no matter what you do in school, they're not going to come to learn. So you have to have some type of outlet to be able to handle them. But AP, to be able to offer a rigorous AP course and a broad variety of AP courses, need to start way before they get to high school, because they need to be prepared for it, even in elementary. So what I say is to go ahead and expose the teachers, pay the teachers to get AP training, instead of them having these outside jobs. Pay them to be trained, so that way we can start that child, as they do over in other foreign countries, like is in China, and some of these other countries that's exceeding our children in math and in science. Start them at an early age, expose them to that type of rigor all the way up, so when they get prepared to go to high school, they're already exposed to and have the expectation of being challenged on every level, especially in science and in math. So I said, the thing is to funnel money back into the teachers so that the teachers can be trained properly, not taking away playing time, but training them for AP courses at every level, elementary, middle school, and high school, so that we can then go ahead and compete with all the other countries that are surpassing us in math and in science. Thank you.
Thank you. I agree with Ms. Mays. I think AP classes need to start about the sixth grade to perform the rigor that a middle schooler needs to have in order when they get to high school, they're prepared to take AP classes and prepared to make fours and fives, because sometimes if you take an AP class and you just make a one or two, it's hardly worth, I won't say worth the effort, but that's not what it's about. It's about to make a four or five and to succeed. The other part is I've been in big schools that have had AP classes, but being a rural superintendent now, I would like for AP classes to be offered for teachers to be trained, and for the state, as far as the state part goes, is to offer AP classes on the virtual school, which it does, and to make our kids more aware. And in rural schools, we have to be more rigorous so that when our children can take those classes in AP in the virtual school, they're prepared for them, and that we have the technology in the rural schools to be able to do this. That's another cost factor, where to drill into computers that can do all this stuff, is that these schools have that opportunity to provide these services for these students in rural schools, urban schools, and suburban schools.
I need to begin by saying that if we use Common Core math that's 1 to 2 years behind where we used to be, our kids aren't going to make it to AP Calculus when they're in high school, so that's the first thing we need to do. Second thing, I was asked by my dean at Mercy University to write an AP incentive grant for Houston County, and it's been several years now that I did that. I've worked with the U.S. Department of Education for 4 years as a grant writer and project director, and I realized that I don't want to work for the U.S. Department of Education. The grant for the AP incentive was a 55-page grant that I wrote, and it wasn't funded. There were 11 funded in the nation, but I'm concerned about local control, and I'm concerned about us using our tax dollars and our federal government money, or you know, our kids' federal government taxes in the future, to incentivize private programs that we don't have control over locally. So let's say there's something in an AP class. My daughter's in AP World History right now, 10th grade. Lots of bright students are in those classes. If a parent comes to me and says, I don't like this or that book that they're reading in that class, and some of them are pretty, we might not want our kids reading those, there's nothing as a school board member that I can do, because it's not run through the school boards. It's run from an agency, a private company. Also, our HOPE scholarship now is going to be based on rigor requirements, and they're going to be required to take these AP classes. So as much as I love advanced education, I would like the direction to be, even though I won't dictate this because I believe in local control, I would like the direction to be for dual enrollment and advanced classes designed and taught by local college professors and K-12 teachers. It'll cost us less. Why should we have to pay the AP program for the test? And why should we stress our kids out to have them do something that, you know, the parents may not even approve of?
Okay, what, how many people have questions? Raise your hand. 1, 2, 3. Because I like to speed it up. I'm gonna give y'all 60 seconds. Is that okay?
Perfect.
Gerald, you ready for 60 seconds? Because I think as we go here, I've got one mic.
Okay. My question is that I hear a lot of people complaining about the standards, but I have yet to hear anybody tell me how they intend to implement a plan to change that so that it won't be a burden and cumbersome on the local boards of education.
Is the feedback okay? Okay, well, the standards, I reject Common Core because it's centralization. Okay, so I don't like central command and control, one size fits all, top down. I think that's just not I'm a Republican. That's not a Republican idea. It's not a conservative idea. It's not a winning philosophy, and it flies in the face of customization. You know, we don't have Ma Bell anymore. We you know, wrote that up for a reason, right? So we can have iPhones and everything. So I don't like that. What I think Common Core is imploding politically right now. I think we've seen Indiana, we're seeing Oklahoma, we'll see other states. 17 states have either pulled out or are pulling out of the assessment. I don't think you go and rip textbooks out of schools and say, you know, and say you've got to buy things, change right away. But I think we will gradually see movement away from that because I think that under the weight of its own problems, it's collapsing. And that's not to say Georgia has strong standards. I think we need to look at what we're doing in Georgia pre-Common Core and after that. So I would negotiate with the Department of Education and other chiefs. Sorry, yes,
statement, that's it. But to state
sorry,
the time we
have
to.
Thank you.
To be honest with you, my plan is to stay the course, and because there's two reasons for this. One, we keep changing on our teachers. We keep changing the curriculum. I'm talking to a math teacher. She said, my curriculum has been changed every year for the past 7 years, and I'm tired, and I'm not an effective teacher because things keep changing. She said, I just want to work with the standards and let them meal around for a bit and find good curriculum that aligns with those standards so that I can be an excellent teacher again, because I'm not an excellent teacher now. Please just give me time. And I said, you know what, I agree with you. ACT, SAT, IB, ITBS have all aligned with Common Core. It is irresponsible if we don't just stay the course and see where it takes us.
And I concur with that. I say keep it simple, smarty. Mainly because GPS was way back when. Before that it was something else, but it all is about the same, which is weird, but it's just new jargon. So I say keep something simple, make it simple. All the things that you're going through now, teacher keys, unbelievable amount of time that we spend doing it. So I say keep it simple. Make it simplified, keep the same course that we have now, but just simplify so everybody can have more time and get the job done.
You want to know why it's confusing? It's a great question. Why it's confusing? Because in this past week, Jeb Bush supports Common Core. Lamar Alexander, Jeb Bush, and Jim Haslam, the governor of Tennessee, support Common Core. Indiana's pulling out. Why? So this is what we're going to do when I'm state school superintendent, is we're going to involve, guess who was developing standards in this state? Teachers. What a unique idea. Golly, those who actually teach the standards can be involved with the standards. And what's right, we can keep. What's not right, we'll figure out what it needs to change too. Because we can't just throw the baby out of the bathwater. Last time I looked in the standards, we still won the American Revolution. Okay? So there are some things we need to understand.
always a fluid item. It always changes because yesterday was history. Yesterday was another math problem. Yesterday we discovered another science creature. So we're going to work with it, with teachers.
The reason why we're having so many controversies over standards is because we have federal laws that say we can't have a national curriculum. So instead of calling it curriculum, they said, well, let's call it standards. And then Iowa was the absolutely last one to get standards, but they had the highest, you know, achievement, so figure that out. This is my Stop Common Core postcard. A friend of mine in Jessup made this. I have been trying to stop Common Core and replace that with local control and educational freedom. Since I did my analysis of the math standards, I saw, and you can see it too in the analysis if you go to my website and download the file, we used to do addition and subtraction with the standard algorithm in second grade. In Common Core, when do we do that? Does anyone know? Fourth grade. We have to wait till fourth grade to teach that standard algorithm, and that's frustrating to me as a math education professor. We also don't do percentages anymore in elementary school. At first, the DOE said the standards were correlated 90%. Oh, darn it.
It's tough to go back. Hey, in 2012, and this is a credit to you, so you can give yourselves a round of applause, that might make me feel good because I'm up here lonely. In 2012, one state in the country moved the needle in the right direction on the SAT, the ACT, advanced placement exam scores, NAEP, reading, math, and science. One state in 2012 moved all of those the correct direction. You know what state it was? Georgia. We are moving in the right direction. No, we haven't arrived. They're not perfect. The standards aren't perfect. We're reviewing them right now, and if we need to make adjustments, we already have a process to do that. Hey, my opinion is not the most important one. Certainly, as state school superintendent, you've got to weigh in on this. But the military supports the standards. The Chamber of Commerce supports it. Business and industry leaders, and oh, teachers, by the way, we surveyed over 11,000 teachers. 75% of them say strongly support or support the standards. We cannot give them the fourth set of standards in a decade to have to try to teach.
Mr. Connolly, who's your next speaker?
I get to? How
yes.
Perfect, because I just thought of what I wanted to say, like how I wanted to say it. You're saying all these people support the standards. One thing that we're not hearing anything from are the parents. The parents are having to take extra classes so they can learn how to do this. I heard of a lady today that 35 parents in their elementary school are getting together to learn this math. There's a whole lot more kids in that. And you know who's going to suffer more? The single parent families.
Wait, let's get a question.
Okay, I am.
Let's move.
So what I want to know is, where are the dissenting voices? Have you heard any of the professional people that are saying things against it? And I think we need to have a consensus. We don't need to just take some people and go at their word. But what my question is, I'm sorry.
Yes, ma'am.
My question is, I just heard today of a nuclear physicist who is against it. So there are other voices. I want to say, have you heard other voices? I'm finished.
There we go.
Well, the neat thing about America is that everybody can have a voice and everybody can have an opinion. However, I have not heard from, I'm a parent. I have a first grader who comes home every day and says, Mommy, I love math. And I'm like, that's really neat, honey, because your mommy hated it. She adores it. She wants to come home and show me everything that she's doing, and she wants to show me the picture that she drew that went with the thing, and she gets it. She understands math. And not just a, oh, well, 5 times 5 is 25. She understands it on a, for lack of a better word, on a visceral level, if you, sorry, English teacher. she gets it. I can't, as a parent, to be honest with you, Common Core, no Common Core, I don't really care. Is my kid learning? Is my child happy? Does she love school? The answer is yes, yes, and yes. She has not missed one day of school, much to her teacher's chagrin. They're like, really? Perfect attendance with your kid? Great. But she's one of those kids. But she loves school. She loves math. She loves what she's doing. And I think that's great.
Dissenting voices. If you ran through halls in schools, you would hear a lot of dissenting voices concerning Common Core and a number of other things. However, because their love for children, they are willing to do what is necessary to make sure that children are being taught. But there is a lot of havoc about Common Core, and they're not interested in Common Core. They're interested in just plain old-fashioned teaching. But what I would say is that from a standpoint of being in getting parents linked to school, because some of the math, I don't even want to try to attempt it. But I think that there has to be some linkage between home and school at the state level, where there may be some type of website or line or a telephone line where a parent can get help, so that whenever they go home, you know, there's teachers that's willing to actually volunteer their time, even some of our retired teachers, to help these parents with this, or help their children with math. Thank you.
All right, this lady kind of, she's been like to all the meetings and stuff, so she's kind of, and she's with Dr. Bacallao. So she likes to ask these questions. So also, your dissenting voice was there when the 50 governors got together. This is the list of governors in 2009 that the people of Georgia elected Governor Perdue emailing the other day. Asked for his feelings and how it went. Well, that is part of your voice when it goes on and you get to vote for the governor who said, I'm going to do this. And you vote for the state school superintendent, Superintendent Cox. Here's your voter thing. It says most voters are for it. So you have your dissenting voice when you vote for your leaders, just like your state school superintendent. So it's up to you as a citizen to read the newspaper, watch CNN, Fox News, because it's all over the news what the governors were going to do. It's not like it was held in Crimea where nobody knew what was going on. It was all in public. You had your chance to go to the forums and express your dissenting voice. Okay?
Thank you. I am the dissenting voice. You know that, don't you? When I went around the state and they were saying that math was 90% correlated with our former GPS, and I did my study and I said, no, it's not 90% correlated. And just recently, now they're coming out and they're saying, oh no, it's 85% correlated. And I'm thinking, how did it go from 90 to 85%? And do they really know how to calculate percentages? Because the standards aren't really listed in a way that you can calculate percentages with those. I mean, if there were 20 of them, then okay, sure. Our kids are not going to understand percentages either, because in the former GPS, the standard read in fifth grade, they will understand the meaning of percentages. And I used to teach that. I used to teach teachers how to teach that. Guess what? In Common Core, it's not in elementary school anymore. It fits. I've taught elementary school for 9 years, and I know kids can learn about percentages.
Yeah, I dare say, as state school superintendent, you're going to hear a dissenting voice on virtually everything at some point in time. What you have to look at is the good of the many and doing the right thing for the vast majority of people. When I talk to people, very few of the dissenting voices have read the standards. The problem is not with the standards. They're not perfect, but most of the people that are dissenting haven't even read the standards. The dissension comes in with how they're delivered and the resources that are selected. And both of those, guess what, are a local decision. And that's where it should be. I believe in local control, and the local school superintendent, local board of education, those boards of education that are elected, they get to select methodology, they get to select the resources. So that's what I've heard, and I've heard long and loud from all the groups that want us to stay the course. And the most important voice that I've heard in that has been the people closest to it, classroom teachers.
I think it's good to point out that all the different changes we've seen before Common Core and the Common Core, they've been brought to you care of the bureaucracy, okay? So we all need to keep that in mind, okay? And they've done so with little input from the classroom teacher, from the parents, from the community, from the citizens. And when Common Core was basically pushed into Race to the Top, so funding would get then mingled with the whole Common Core discussion, they said, yeah, we'll adopt Common Core. They hadn't even written the standards yet, so people didn't have a time to vet that. So just remember that bureaucracy has brought you the flip-flopping and all the problems, and bureaucracy did this before ever looking at what these standards were. That's just really not good management. That's a problem. So you deserve better. You deserve transparency, not somebody saying, you know, trust me, I'm going to, you know, keep going down this path.
Yes, what I'd like to ask is, as state school superintendent, how would you address a concern with, we've talked a lot about college, getting into four-year colleges and stuff like that, but this large number of students who get lost, we try to drag them through school to get them a diploma. If we would redirect these students into technical education, earlier, we recognize this, I know, in middle school. This is not something that's secret. But how can we direct those? How can you direct these students into the technical college to better their chances of getting a diploma as well as being much better prepared to enter into a productive workforce and not end up in a poverty level that most likely they're going to have a hard, hard time escaping once they enter into that?
I think that the key to that is to exposure. In schools, we're so driven about getting a diploma, but we're not really looking at the aspect of real life in terms of giving them skills in school. Even in middle school, it needs to start in middle school, because some children, that may not be what they want to do. They may not have a desire to go to college. It might not be a possibility to them. So we need to start exposing them in middle school, taking up trades in middle school, and showing them other alternatives at that point where they're making decisions, and that they can make a decision in terms of doing other things technically, which still will supply them with reasonable income, such as right now there's a big thing with pacemakers where you can go to take up a trade and be to clean instruments and get paid good money just for something as simple as pacemakers. It's called a pacemaker some type of technology, technologist or technician. So in other words, exposing children to what is coming for the future, knowing what's coming for the future in terms of job open and availability.
My plan would be to identify these students, and I would actually go back in time almost and to identify these young men and young women who wanted to be auto mechanics, welders, electricians, beauticians, homemade people. I would like to make sure they got spend the second part of their 11th grade year really immersed in a trade in the school. And then if they have done everything they're supposed to do in life and they're in the 11th grade, I would like to graduate them and let them go on to a trade school, take their FTE money, go to a trade school during their senior year, and learn a trade. I don't offend an English teacher in here, but for my buddies Jim Bob and Don Pavis that I always call, Shakespeare don't really matter. Fourth year mathematics doesn't really matter at that point. If we could get these kids out into the world of work and not put them through that last year, because a lot of these kids might have been retained. And so they're approaching 18 and 19 years old. They're going to drop out of age, ladies and gentlemen.
Over here for the last one, since I feel like I'm neglecting you guys over here. We built the best educational system in the world in this country, and it was all based on local control. So as state school superintendent, I want to put that decision making back to the local school boards and the local community members. If a parent and a student wants to take a vocational technical program, they should be able to, and they shouldn't be restricted and limited
almost, House Bill 897 almost passed, which would have restricted the career cluster choices to copyrighted and trademark choices that are owned by Achieve, the same people who own the Common Core. So I was really glad that didn't pass. That's a step in the right direction for kids being able to choose their careers and be able to have flexible programs in their communities, not something dictated by Washington, D.C.
You know, the dropout rate is not caused by lack of aptitude in most of our young people. It's caused because our young people do not see the relevance in what they're learning. We have got to help them see beyond Friday night football game and who they're going to take to the prom. We've got to help them discover their passion. Because I promise you, if young people are passionate about whatever the content is, then they're going to apply themselves. There are many, many different paths in life. There are those young people that want to leave high school and go to work, and that's okay. And in the medical cluster, we have 17 clusters. There's a CNA, you can leave high school with a certified nursing assistant. Those jobs pay about $28,000 a year, and they're begging for people in those fields. You can leave high school and go into a radiology technician type career 2 years beyond high school. Starting salary gets up around $60,000. They beg for those people. You can go into an RN or pre-med and go in a four-year program of study, all within the medical cluster.
You know, it's how you spend your money is going to drive your results. And I applaud you for talking very passionately and being an advocate for technical education. Some districts are doing a great job with it, and they are hindered by the bureaucracy of the DOE when they want to talk about Carnegie units and credit over, you know, and I want to be an obstacle remover as state school superintendent for those places that are doing it right. And we have to upgrade our funding formula, because that is a real big detriment, because they lose funding for when kids go into those dual enrollment technical things, and we've got to incentivize it. It's all about structuring the right incentive. So you need somebody who recognizes that and can do that. Other states are doing it. Tennessee's made great strides there. We need somebody who is looking across the nation and seeing these best practices and then implementing them right here, because kids can do very well. That is a great on-ramp to a middle-class lifestyle, and where they can support their family and have a wonderful, productive life.
She got her car unlocked.
No, I didn't.
Oh, no.
They keep calling and then leaving. So I again, y'all, I apologize. I'm like a hot mess tonight. But CTAE, school choice, we absolutely need to give CTAE teeth. We need to afford our children the ability, again, to follow their passion, to follow their promise, to make sure that they are able to choose which courses that they want to take. And this works in the small counties too, Alan, so pay attention. What we can do is we can make sure that our schools and our school systems are, the superintendents are working together and saying, hey, I can do agriculture, hey, I can do engineering, hey, I can do welding, and then have, and it's called intra-school choice. So the money follows the child, they follow their passions, they follow their promise, and nobody loses any FTE funds.
Well, you said working together, that's a unique idea.
It's crazy, isn't it?
Got one more question, Mark.
One question.
Here we go. Okay.
According to the federal government, I'm almost reading this right off their website, it's in 1930, and I'll get to the question, I'm just happy about it. 1930, there were approximately 248,000 public schools. In 2010, there were approximately 99,000. I suggest that this is much of our issue that we're dealing with. We're talking about overpopulation in classrooms and what have you. My question, what would you back a push to expand alternative education, such as homeschool, you know, internet schooling, and that kind of thing, to offset that population issue that we're dealing with?
That's good, because we've not had that question really before. I think I'm a strong believer in public education. I'm a product of it. But I'm also a strong believer in parental choice, that if they want to homeschool, if they want to, you want to send them to a charter school, a private school, I spent 3 years in a private school. And we have squeezed schools together to make large. My child, my son graduated from high school with 3,300 students. I wish it was about a third of that. And so I think we need to go back to look at the size of schools, reduce the number of kids in a school. We need 30 more seconds. But the other side of the fact is that when you have six schools instead of 12 schools, you've got buses having to travel to six extra schools. And you've got six extra janitorial staff and six extra lunchroom staff and six extra sets of secretaries and six extra sets of teachers, which you might be. And so you have to think about those things also.
What I hear you saying is we have half the number of schools that we had
We have about half as many schools as we used to have. So that means probably the number of students has doubled in schools. In Fayette County, we closed four schools last year, and I was the only one that voted against closing those four schools because I believe that small schools are more effective and discipline is easier. You don't need as much bureaucracy when you have a smaller school. And I predicted that we would actually save money by keeping those schools open. I was right. It ended up that we lost money by closing the schools because the number of students that we lost didn't even make up for what we saved. We ended up saving only $15 million, but that was all teacher salaries. And we ended up increasing our general administration budget to handle the overcrowded schools, and now we have long car lines.
Having been an elementary school principal with about 400 students and a high school principal with about 1,400 students, I like a smaller school. I like to know the children by name. I like to know their parents. So when it's feasible, I like a smaller setting. I think we have to offer a wide variety of educational services. I believe parents have the absolute right to select whatever educational delivery system they believe is best for their child. As state school superintendent, I just want to make public education that choice for the parents.
I'm familiar with a study that talks a little, sort of hints at what you're doing. I'm Milton Friedman, and I'm a big Milton Friedman. That's sort of my philosophy for those of you who know about Milton. So he wrote a paper and talked about the great consolidation of school districts. And when we started the 1900s, we had over 100,000 school districts, and today we have 14,000-ish school districts. So you've seen that great consolidation, and we've seen the growth of bureaucracy. That is a problem. We sort of have an 8-track system now in the iPod world, and so the hybrid models, homeschooling, hybrid on-ramps and off-ramps back into public school, we need all of those things, and we don't have any thought leaders on this in Georgia, and that's something I bring to the table. I talk about this, I research this, I have published on these subjects, so you're absolutely right. We need a leader who can give us some of those innovations to help the classroom environment. Thanks, Nancy. So, yes, there was a decentralization of schools and local schools and making them bigger, and it was done for cost effectiveness. And what happened was many local school communities became disengaged with the school and the school that their children were attending. Whereas when we were coming up, the school was sort of the heart of the community, the school and the church. And that's not the case anymore. Your question was, does that support different alternatives to traditional public school? And I think absolutely yes. I think parents should be asking themselves every day, what is best for my child? I think that communities need to be asking themselves every day, what is best for our children? And I think that schools also need to be doing the same thing. As a parent, my daughter loves public school. She's thriving there. She's doing great. I'm not so sure about my little boy. And that decision will be made when he gets there. And if it means charter school, if it means homeschool, if it means private school, then I as a parent need to be able to make that decision, and I need the freedom and the choice to be able to make that decision.
I think that's an excellent question. With this time that we have today, we're actually dealing with things that are changing from when we were children, and we need to probably get with the program because it's gonna change either with us or without us. One such thing is what I'm thinking about is Charles Darwin. He talked about survival of the fittest. It's not the strongest that survive. It's not the most intelligent, but it's one that's willing to adapt and to change. And that's what we have to do with the new, with whatever superintendent. Because, as you know, even with college and homeschool, virtual school, all these things deal with computer now, you don't have to go anywhere anymore. It's all with you at home now, or in your car, wherever you go. So we need to adapt the time and make it useful to us where we can use our fundings to do what we need to do to get the job done.
Great. Well, thank you. Let's give these folks a hand. They can take a side now, but I want to recognize a few folks I didn't do at the very beginning. One of our county commissioners, Rob Jones, Commissioner Chairman's right back here. Hey, Rob. In our school system, our superintendent is Dr. Perry, right there in the blue wave. It's Lowe, right there beside her. Venture right in the middle of there. Now they're trying to make a quick break. That's what I'm trying to figure out. And also Miss Andrews right here. And we sure appreciate them being here. Well, I hope it's worth your time. You know, that it was time well spent listening to these folks and listening to their passion. I think I heard that from all of them. I think you know that education is important to them. That's important to y'all. That's why we're here. If you look on your agenda that we gave out, we've included their contact information. I saw somebody else do that in the meeting I was at last year, and it's very helpful.
Mine is easy. It's nancy@nancyjester.com. So I think that's all that's missing. And on my card, you have my phone number and my email as well.
Okay. It's on the card. And yours is on your cards, or do you need to?
Mine is marykbacallao@hotmail.com. And it's, if you got the bookmark, it's on the back in the very small part and bottom. And I also have a website if you want to look at on any of the research that I put up there. I have a whole thick Excel spreadsheet of my math study, and that's at marykbacallao.jimdo.
Everybody's got a website. Everybody wants that 30 seconds. They all have websites. I've looked at each one of them, okay? But I think you'll have a question a week from now. I mean, I do. I've got some questions. I made some notes of some things I want to find out. We're going to stay around. You've got questions for them. I hope you grab them by the ear or just let them know your things. But thank you, retired educators. Our Pickens County folks, appreciate you putting this on tonight. Thank you. Gerald wants to say one thing.
I want to thank you guys again for coming, especially our candidates. I think we can leave now better informed, Alan. And appreciate you guys attending. And what are we going to do May the 20th? Go vote! Thank you.